Hi, I'm Abby Sullivan. I'm the Program and Communications Coordinator here at the Wagner Free Institute of Science. And you are standing in the exhibition hall, the museum space of the Wagner. This building has been around since 1865, but we actually were founded 10 years earlier by William Wagner in 1855. He is what we call a gentleman scientist, so he actually wasn't practicing science himself, but he was a merchantman, and he was lucky enough to travel the world. He got to go to Europe, North Africa, different parts of the world, and he collected specimens his entire life. He really loved rocks, minerals, shells, and science really just was his passion. So he was lucky enough to retire in his 40s, and this was his passion, so he decided to found a place where people could access free science education. So this was pretty unheard of in the mid-19th century. Most people would have to be pretty affluent to be getting a good education. So this really was sort of the part of the whole movement to democratize education. So 1850s, he founds the Institute. He started it out of his summer home, which was just north of this site. And he really turned sort of a wing of his house into a cabinet of curiosities type museum space, and started inviting people to come and learn about conchology or mineralogy. So he started giving these free lectures, and he always held them in the evening so that people who worked all day could attend at night. Women could attend, people of any race or religion. This really was kind of unheard of in the 1850s. And by 1865, he had this building completed. End of the Civil War, it was finished, and it has an enormous lecture hall that could hold close to 500 people, and also is this museum exhibition space. We have over 100,000 specimens. A lot of the collection was added after William Wagner's death, but as I said, he does, his hand is all over the place. He did collect a lot of the rocks, minerals, and shells that you see. After he died, the board took over and very quickly appointed Joseph Leidy, who is a very prominent Philadelphia scientist. He had ties, he was working at Swarthmore, University of Pennsylvania. He was running the Academy of Natural Sciences. He really was doing a little bit of everything everywhere. They call him the last man who knew everything. Incredible scientist. He really wanted to make the Wagner into what he called a first-rate institution. So he expanded the collections. He started doing active research and publishing those findings in what were called the Transactions of the Wagner Free Institute of Science. He also organized expeditions. So Wagner-sponsored expeditions were sent across North America. We have a lot of type specimens, so that being the first specimen of that species that was found that everything else is named after. So we have the first saber-toothed cat of North America was found by a Wagner-sponsored expedition. So Joseph Leidy's hand really is all over this museum, probably more so even than William Wagner's. He really was the one who expanded the collection. He bought a lot of the taxidermy, the skeletons. He made it more of a complete academic, the type of collection a natural history museum would have had. And he's also the one responsible for laying out the museum the way you see it. And this display is called a systematic display, and it really reflects the ideas, the early ideas of evolution at the time. So 1891, this collection was displayed, and basically looks the same today. You will see as you walk around, a couple of the labels were changed over time, but generally the cabinets, where they're located, where the specimens are located, has been the same since the 1890s. So you're really stepping back into a time capsule. This is what a natural history museum looked like in the 1890s. The Academy of Natural Sciences in Philadelphia at one point looked like this. They later adopted the whole diorama display. Most natural history museums did. So this really reflects a snapshot in time from the 1890s of what natural science museums would have looked like. So I think one of the most amazing things about the Wagner is not only that the museum hasn't changed since the 1890s, but also our mission hasn't changed since the 1850s. We still carry out William Wagner's vision to create a space where people can come and access free science education. So what I do at the Wagner is programs for adults, but that's only part of what we do. We also work with children. So we have open houses throughout the year. That's for families to come check out the space. We do different thematic programs. One of my favorite is the Natural History Roadshow, sort of like the Antiques Roadshow, where you can bring in a specimen that you found, sort of like William Wagner, who collected wherever he went. If you collect something from the woods or a shell from the beach, you can bring it in, and we have a panel of experts that will identify it. So that's one of our open houses. That's just one example. We also work with North Philadelphia elementary schools and middle schools. We work with four different schools, and we do intense year-long science curriculum with them. We have fellows from St. Joseph's University that we work extremely closely with. And we really bring high-level science to these underserved schools in North Philadelphia. So that's a really incredible program. We also have a new program called SNAP, which stands for Science, Nature, and Art in Philadelphia. It's an out-of-school time program. That's for middle school students, and that's been extremely successful. It's a ton of fun. We basically pair scientists and artists and have them do lessons with the kids and work on projects that are science and art related, and really that cross-section of where those two intersect. I do the adult programs, so we do weeknight lectures throughout the year. We have an annual Westbrook lecture, which is a very large lecture that's supposed to look at something controversial in science. We do a science cafe monthly with four other institutions at National Mechanics Bar in Old City. Science cafes are a ton of fun. You basically bring a speaker in to talk to people while they eat food and drink beer, and it's a ton of fun. So we do that once a month. We also do different festivals throughout the year. We do the Honey Festival, the Science Festival, a whole bunch of stuff. So we've really been doing also those free science courses in the evening, just like William Wagner did. We've been doing those for over 158 years. And that's actually part of why we're a National Historic Landmark, because we have the longest running free adult science program in the country. One of our recent programs that we did for the Science Festival, we invited a mycologist. His name is Paul Stamets. He's what we call the mushroom guru. He's really fascinating. He does research into how mushrooms and mycelium can be used for ecological restoration, how they can sort of filter E. coli out of soil from agriculture, how mycelium could be used to help build up soils for wetland restoration, all different applications. Also looks at the health side of mushrooms. There's some very promising studies that show that certain mushrooms can greatly reduce the risk of cancer and boost your immune system. So really fascinating work. We've done work on basically conserving our entomology collection. Bug collections are one of the hardest things for natural history museums to protect because, ironically, you have other bugs that come in and eat the old dead bugs. So we have done extensive work on our entomology collection. You know, we have a site manager who's really fantastic about taking care of the collections. So that's a big part of what we do. It actually became formally part of our mission, is to protect the collections in the building. So that is, we take it very seriously here. So a large part of the collection upstairs, this whole west side of the building is fossils, minerals, rocks. And this, as I said, a lot of it was collected by William Wagner. And the cool thing is that it goes from geological time, from the oldest items to the newest. We have a lot of fossils from very important sites around the world. Lyme Regis, where some of the first dinosaurs and extinct species were ever really imagined and fathomed. We have ichthyosaurs, which were discovered by a woman named Mary Anning. She was 12 years old when she discovered them in Lyme Regis. And this really, you know, it's, we're talking about the time in history when people were first confronted with the idea that there used to be things living on the earth that are no longer here. So we have a lot of important specimens in that way that came from really important geological locations. We don't have any complete articulate dinosaurs, but we do have dinosaur bones and fossils. A lot of these things were collected locally, but we also have specimens that came from around the world. We have a bunch of megafauna down the center of the museum. We have a really large draft horse. We have a bison. We have all kinds of monkeys. We have a very large bird collection. We have some extinct species in the collection. We have a Rocky Mountain locust, which was famous for creating the plague of locusts in the 1920s, I believe it was, when they ate all the crops and contributed to the whole Dust Bowl. And we have lots of specimens, sadly, that are endangered today. And unfortunately, it seems like that list of endangered specimens that we have is going to continue to grow.